If you are like me and end up prototyping on a breadboard where your components end up being loose and making it very difficult to troubleshoot, take your projects or your prototyping to the next level by going to PCBWay and getting a proper PCB manufactured for your prototyping or your next project. Simply head over to the PCBWay website and click on Instant Quote, and there you can provide the specifications and the requirements for your project and simply place your order. Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this T4D, where I'm going to give you an update across several projects and things which have come into the lab for review. So first of all, let me start off with the first bit of kind of big news, if you will. I've just spent the last week and a bit working on the cottage power supply project. I've had the PCBs come in from PCBWay. I did this without them knowing. I paid for it out of my own money, and I'm glad I did, because there were many lessons learned that I might not have if I had used their assistance. I'll talk a little bit more about this when we get down to the bench, but I do have them here. You'll notice it's fairly big, and that's going to be one of the interesting topics. So first of all, I'll just lead you in a little bit of a teaser into the video. I'm going to do two videos on the cottage power supply project after this one. Basically, this PCB cost me, excluding the shipping, because you can get various shipping rates, this cost me $11 per PCB. Now, if you're not that familiar with PCB production and what have you, $11 is a fair bit of money. I had to do this in a rush. I literally spent a week teaching myself KiCad and muddling my way through it and then getting the design done. It was a Friday afternoon, literally 5 o'clock. I needed to start a new project the next week, and I just had to get this in. And I knew there were certain things I could do better, but I also knew it was a prototype. And we're going to talk about that, prototyping on a PCB and whether it's viable or not. I worked out after the fact that as opposed to $11 per PCB, I could get this down to potentially $1 or $2 per PCB. And I'm going to talk about how that can be done and the simple selections and design criteria you need to bear in mind as a newbie like me, if you're not familiar with this kind of process and doing your own PCBs, how to be mindful of certain things which can suddenly explode the cost of a PCB if you're not too careful. But we'll have a look at that when we get to the bench. The other thing I know folks have been asking about, solar power projects. I did send a note out to my patrons, because I do get these emails coming in all the time, like, will you review this solar panel or this power bank or what have you. I had one of these requests. I went to my patrons and I said, hey, would you be interested in this product? You know, it's a little power bank with a solar panel. And they said, yeah, hey, that'd be cool. And I went back to the company, and it's the first time this has ever happened. So they came back and said, okay, fine. Here's the link on Amazon. You buy the product, post a review on Amazon, and then we'll pay you back. And I'm like, nah, I'm not doing that. It's the first time that has ever happened. But that is the problem with a lot of these folks wanting things reviewed. Sometimes they'll say, oh yes, we give the product to you for free, and then as soon as it arrives, because they see the tracking, they want the review then and there, and they want a favorable review. So again, I have to be very careful with who I deal with. There is my solar powered coffee table. There's a potential also maybe of an electric car in the near future, and I'll talk about that if that does come to realization. Perhaps if I have a cheap electric car and set up something where it's going to be solar powered when I come to work. So we'll talk about that. There's also a company who is developing a power storage system which you can put in your house, kind of like a power wall. They have been communicating with me for a long time. They're trying to get the product into the States. They've been working with compliance issues with the FCC. If that happens, it could be quite a big and interesting product, which if it's put into my hands, will be either installed in the cabin or at my house. So there are those things, but I say, some of the projects I've been busy on at the moment just do chew my time. A quick update on the LTO battery or cell testing, which I've been doing. You all have seen in the past, I spoke about that. I've stopped the testing. Why have I stopped the testing? Nothing's gone wrong. It's just boring. I have put this LTO cell through anywhere between, I think, about 120 and 200 cycles, and it has not lost any of its storage capability at all, which is very unusual for anything else I've tested. As soon as you start go through like 50, 100, 150 cycles, you're going to see a degrading of the battery or the cell in terms of the amount of storage that it can do. And this simply hasn't. So I'm going to collate and compile all those results into an Excel spreadsheet so you can actually see the exact number of cycles and the stats on that. So that's something that's coming up, but I thought I'd just let you know. The other thing that was brought to my attention, someone sent me an email and mentioned a new YouTube channel. It's very small. The gent has only just started, but it's called Duality Repair. It's an electronics channel and repair channel. And the gent, although he's only starting out and has a very small audience, he does a very good presentation and production of his videos. And I think if you enjoy my videos, you might certainly enjoy his videos. And I think it's always fantastic to go and support, particularly in the electronics genre, which can be very niche, is to go and support someone who's starting out, who's doing good work. So I'm going to put the link up here, the name of it. I'll also post a link in the details below. Right then, so I'm not going to give too much away right now, but I'm just going to kind of giving you an aerial view of the PCB assembled, and it is working. Not without quite a bit of head scratching and a little bit of frustration because it didn't work straight off. So there's been a lot of learning through the process, and if you've had any half interest in the power supply project, I think you'll find the next two videos of interest, where I go through certainly the mistakes I made in the design and layout of this board. The one first obvious one which should strike you is how big it is, right? There's a lot of empty space. This can be shrunk down, and that's going to save up to 30% of the cost in what you see here. And then just a few other selections. When you go onto, let's say, PCBWay's website and you make selections in the choice of certain parameters of the board, that can radically affect the cost as well. So I'm going to talk about that because they weren't on the top of my thoughts when I was going through this process. So I've certainly learned a bit. The next thing I want to cover, and again, the reason I'm kind of just giving a quick overview of these products before I do the review, is because I'm very sensitive when I kind of get to do a review of an item that an individual has sent me. You know, companies, they have to wait on the back burner. I always tell folks, if you're sending things to me, depending on my backlog, it could take 2 to 3 months before I get to review an item or a product. But if someone has gone out of their way to make and develop something, I kind of want to get it out there as quick as I can, but I have had my hands full. So the first one is this product, and it's by a gent by the name of Ian. He works for a railroad company in California, and that's where he came up with this idea. They're using two-way radios. They on a train, and obviously when you're at a certain speed, you're going to get wind noise coming into your two-way radio. So he decided to develop this product. He spent a few years doing it. He's got the patent for the USA market, and it's a very simple design. He's got really nice packaging, and it's a shield which simply clips over the radio, so over the kind of a speaker microphone area to block wind noise. Now, I haven't tested this yet, but I'm going to test it. I'm just bringing it to your attention, but I'm certainly keen to see how well this works. And if it does, it's a very simple solution to blocking wind noise, to helping prevent dirt and what have you getting into the radio speaker, potentially. We'll see. I'm going to try it on several different radios and see how well it works. What I will do in the meantime, I'm going to, you've obviously got the name here, it's called the Sahara Shield. I'm going to give you the website details as well. So if you want to go ahead and have a look, perhaps go and purchase one ahead of the review, you can, but I certainly will review it to see how effective it is. Yeah. So thanks very much to Ian for sending that in. Then another gent, and I'm not even going to try and slaughter his name because I'm not going to pronounce it properly. I'm going to put it down here. He brought to my attention that he had developed this professional laptop battery analyzer. And initially, when I first came across the idea that this basically can rejuvenate laptop batteries, I was a little bit skeptical, to be honest. But I saw an independent company doing a review of this, and I realized that there's a lot of intelligence built into laptop batteries for their BMS or their battery management, and that can sometimes trip them up. And this device, both the hardware and the software that this good gent has written, basically analyzes them and can give you a real understanding whether there is a fault, the capacity, and even bring them back if there's a technical issue which the battery is stumping itself with. So that sounds a bit odd, I know, but I say I'm going to take the time out, get a few batteries, and we'll go through exactly how this device works. I'll post a link in the description below to the review that has been done if you want to get a head start and have a look at it. But I'll certainly be doing a review on this. I know he actually struggled to get one of these to me because he has been selling out of them so quickly. So they've become that popular that he literally cannot keep up with demand with selling these. But anyway, so that is coming up in the future. So then the last one is this wristwatch. Now, I'll tell you up front that this wristwatch, right, is not pretty. It cost $100 off Amazon. You can find them on various websites. In terms of design and what have you, it doesn't appeal to me at all. I mean, it's like got this 80s, well, not even 80s, 90s, probably 60s, 70s style elasticated band, which one shouldn't poo-poo straight away. I could see a lot of benefits to a band like this, but it's certainly not your kind of in vogue kind of band that you'd have on a wristwatch. A white face and silver hands is not a great design because they tend to disappear. So what has drawn me to this watch? For one, it is solar powered. And this is one of the only wristwatches that I know of where you can actually go and digitally trim the timekeeping. I have two other watches in my collection where you can go and change a trim pot or a capacitor to vary the speed of the capacitor. But generally speaking, once a watch comes out of the factory or manufacturer and they've hard-coded the calibration into it, that's it. I've heard of watches where you can take them to a watchmaker, and I'm talking about particularly quartz watches now, not mechanical watches, but you can take them to a watchmaker and they can do an adjustment because the factory allows some adjustment, perhaps with a special tool. This, you simply go into the setup, and it's got a setup feature where you can adjust with seconds per month, up to, I think it's 90 seconds per month, plus 90 or minus 90. Now that's not potentially not going to give you a good resolution or accuracy over a year, I think. I stand to be corrected. But I have started playing with it, and I've managed to start to trim this to bring it in line. I'm going to see what I can do, but I say, just an interesting one. It is the only wristwatch that I know of where you can actually do digital trimming by just simply holding down a button and changing the setting. If anyone else knows of any other wristwatch, quartz wristwatch, that you can do that with, I'd be really keen for you to bring it to my attention. Certainly post something in the comments below. Okay, so again, apologies for such a quick video. For me, such a quick video. I just wanted to say, give a quick status update. I do appreciate it when individuals come along and either highlight other YouTube channels or projects which could do with a bit more of a spotlight. If you do know of some either interesting products, or even I'd say if you've got submissions for the oddball products, then certainly post those. I certainly will try and get round to those. At the moment, I say I do want to finish the college supply project. I know for a fact that even once we have this boxed and working and the PCB finalized, there could be some interesting updates to it. But we'll talk about that, I say, in the next two videos. But anyway, thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.